So you're a philosopher?
Yes. 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 I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply.
Hey, what's up, you guys? It's Head Coach Ross of the Attack's Gym Street Warriors, and Gio Uhuru, the Street Warrior himself, coming for action. You may not be able to see him right now, but my cousin, assistant coach Phil, is here, you know, and we're about to get into it.
Yes, yes.
You know, this is really significant. This is actually another installment of the clap. Actually, it's really shots fired. This is like a clap back, meaning a response to, you know, some questions that we were asked. And I'm going to do this also in Portuguese and in Spanish as well, so everybody can understand. And I'm going to try to have this this particular video with the Portuguese subtitles to it. But we know that Google sucks at translation, so you know, work with me there. You know, it's the computer tripping if they say something that doesn't make sense. All right, so follow with us. You know, there's a whole series of questions that we're throwing our way. And when I get right at it, you know, what was one of the ones that you think about?
Let's start first things first. What is the purpose of this series, the new series, Shots Fired? Why is it here?
Good question. The purpose of the Shots Fired is this. I'm taking a more direct and more straightforward approach to shooting knowledge and accurate information at all of you to eradicate the long-standing, highly divisive, thoroughly untrue misinformation, miseducation that you've received. The result of this misinformation and miseducation is the stratification and division, you know, not only of Brazil, all right, but to stratify and divide us essentially across the world through a combination of the feudal system and racism combined. So ultimately, it doesn't matter who you are. As long as you're part of the great 99.9% of us who aren't the Trumps in the world, all right, the Trumps in the world are going to try to screw you. Now, where you're going to be on a boat that's basically sinking. Where you are on the boat and how close you are to the sinking will be determined directly by your race and your economic status.
Yeah.
If you're black and broke, you're under the boat right now. That's why I'm seeing you, because I'm under the boat too. I'm right next to you, right? You know, right? Just holding the boat up, trying to climb back up in that mug, and the brothers are trying like, no, man, there's not enough space. You know, if you're white and broke, you're at the front of the boat, you know, and it's tilted up, all right? If you're white male and broke, you're at the front of the boat, a boat, and it's tilted up, and that is close to the water, but that won't make too much of a difference to you when the Kraken reaches out the water and grabs you with its tentacles. You're like, I'm farther up, but you know what? I'm still getting swallowed. You know, when the big snakes come and get you. You start singing that song when we were kids, remember? When your kids in elementary school, I'm being swallowed by a boa constrictor. Remember that? Your race will not be mattering when you're being steadily digested.
Sure, you know?
Now, the rest of us, we've been digested first, so we mad. We mad first. But but all of us will be digested by the boa constrictor, you know, because we're all part of the 99.9%. If we let the Trumps of the world or the people who ejected the president of Brazil, Dilma, we let them continue to go on as they are unchallenged right now. The subject of capoeira, misquad capoeira, is a perfect microcosm of exactly that, because in and of itself, all by itself, it encompasses and it encapsulates all of the struggles, all the issues of race, gender, nationality, education, religion, music, the stratification of society on all these classic lines has happened as a result of the combination of feudalism and racism. What's up, yo? You know, all right. You know, in a single flow. And that's what separates basically us, those of us who practice my family's art in Jiwu, Kifuna, you know, from those of us who practice what the enemy, our collective enemy, wants you to practice. They want you to practice what the art that they call capoeira, you know, and they give you all kinds of misinformation about that. I'm here to untangle, to de-snarl, to be straight at with you about that. I'm going to put these shots fired right through your cranium and right through their lives. And then together, we'll arm up with the knowledge we have and we'll put the shots fired on these guys. We'll shoot down all the ignorance. We'll shoot down our divisions. We'll shoot down dysfunction. We'll shoot down all of the stupidities that are preventing us from appreciating each other as a whole, celebrating our differences and recognizing our similarities. Now, I'm not trying to sound like we are the world and, you know, the Rainbow Coalition and all that other good stuff. I don't even like half the flavors on the rainbow, so, you know, all right, I'm just keeping it real, right?
But you make a good point. I mean, you know, to our detractors, look at the diversity just in the videos that we shoot. You know, we have Anthony and, you know, brothers and sisters of all flavors.
Indeed, including the passersby who actually stop and watch our video.
Absolutely.
You know, and that includes you, the viewership here. What some of the detractors try to say, they try to say stuff like, you're not even, oh, well. You don't even practice the wrong. As I stated to you before, it's wrong in every possible way. The very first time that you refer to an African art by the not only by a non-African tongue, but in a tongue that was assigned to it by the enemies, the people who hated the African. People who sought to enslave the Africans, sought to destroy the art, sought to destroy the practitioners, sought to distort every form of history, you know, and every facet of resources and civilization to their own self-aggrandizement, and at the expense of most especially the Africans. You are proven that you are not worth trusting. Let me put you like this: remember when China and Japan were going to war? Remember they had static. How many people in Zhongguo, which is one of the correct terms for China, how many Zhongguore, which was Chinese people, how many of them called Wushu, Kung Fu, Karate? You think about that. See what happens if you just backslide your way over there to any place in Manchuria and get to or Beijing to watch you some Wushu and be like, oh, that's some sweet Karate. See what happens.
Yeah.
See what happens to you. Now, imagine if the same Japanese had enslaved the Chinese for hundreds of years, tried to superimpose their language upon the Chinese and their interpretation of history.
Religion and everything
and
else.
And everything else.
Yes.
Everything. They tried to extinguish the indigenous religion and superimpose the version of their religion that they wanted the Chinese to have, which was designed to deify the Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and to teach the perpetuation of the prostrate role, the dependent role, the justification of the enslavement of the Chinese. Imagine that happened. And then one of the Chinese jumped up like, "No, I'm a sleep warrior. All right, it is Wushu Kung Fu, and the hell with you and you too. You know, right? The house Negro Chinese are gonna be like, no, Master said it's capoeira. That's what you're looking at.
Yeah.
That is what you're looking at. Now we're gonna get into this. It sounds to you like I put some shots fired on some of the old school messengers like Pastina and Bimba who are not sellouts. No, there's a difference between miseducation and selling out. All right. Also, because you did not do your history, because you get scared every time I pull out a book, you just duck, you start running. You know, right? Every time I pull out a book. You know, like, no, I might have to get educated and do some history and just, yeah, because you don't do that. They deliberately put their knowledge and their information in books, not for you, all right, but to perpetuate the knowledge for them. So you don't even understand what Bimba and Pastina were doing because you don't have a proper grasp of that time period. You don't know. You don't know that Pastina didn't even teach a fighting system. He learned the fighting system, but he didn't teach that fighting system. There's some of you right now who are mad. I can see right now, I just read some, I'm a student of Mestre Zhao Grange. I'm a student of, you know, whoever the hell he is. And yeah, you can't scrap either.
Oh, that's wow.
Just a point blank truth.
Yeah.
You can't scrap. If you could, I wouldn't be here pointing out how you can't scrap. What? Okay, let me see your gun design.
Yeah.
Why am I even bringing up gun design? Because there's a group called Osawagos, the people who are famously the source of the Pahanawe song in Brazil. Happy, I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. Osawagos was a all African fighting regiment forced and pressed into service in, you know, into Brazil back during the time when they had the Paraguayan War, which is actually called the Triple Alliance War. Triple Alliance. What is that? Go read a book. I know I scared you. All right? Now, go read a book, though. Stop, you know, stop being scared. I'm not going to give you all the information on purpose. I'm going to give you some points to start off with. But I'm not going to give you all the information on purpose. Go do some, go read. Go learn. Now, Os Zouaves, they famously, repeatedly did the gun disarm I showed. On the battlefield. They did it on the battlefield. These cats zigged and zagged on cannon fire. They climbed up the invincible, you know, redoubted fortress that was repudiating and refuting and slaying all the other troops, the Brazilian troops, the Portuguese troops, and everybody else that was part of the Triple Alliance. These brothers, these Quiporo warriors, overran that fortress. And in the process of doing so, they achieved their freedom. Now, how did they achieve their freedom? Well, the truth is, the Portuguese commander who pressed them into service and then, quote unquote, offered them freedom because he believed that nobody would survive. No one had survived. That no one had even crossed the middle ground between, you know, the Portuguese Triple Alliance forces and the Paraguayan forces. But these brothers and sisters not only made it across, these brothers and sisters overwhelmed the enemy. And the Portuguese commander, the Brazilian commander, both were so amazed and so pleased that they didn't have to get themselves killed running across military. Let's keep it 100 now, yeah. Right? They were so happy that they didn't have to get themselves killed. They were more than happy to say, we're going to give these brothers their freedom. Now, you're thinking that's a magnanimous gesture. It's not. See, because if these brothers had stayed, they would have dispersed and dispensed their fighting system up to the other brothers and sisters who were still being enslaved in that same army.
There you go.
You know what would have happened? The next war would have been featured these brothers and sisters doing to the Brazilians what they just did to the Paraguayans. Think method, that through.
Method to the madness.
Method to the madness. So these brothers and sisters were real happy. The Os Zouaves were real happy. They were coming back home and they're singing Pahanawe. That's how that song started. That's where it came from. It came from warriors who do what I do, not what you do. They were practicing the real art, which is what I do, not what you do. Point blank. You're not doing it. You're not, and I'm going to prove it. That's what Shots Fired is going to show you. Now, to really emphasize this point, I'm going to delve into other critical elements and areas of history that will really make the point home. You know, I'm going to add to this video the relevant visual cues, because some of you, well, actually quite a few of you, have no idea what the hell I'm talking about. You know, right? If I say to you that the Quilombo, which is really properly called Ngolo Zango, but which the Portuguese called, the Brazilians called, Dos Palmares, meaning two palm trees, because the gigantic two palm trees which flank the entry to the Quilombo. 95% of you don't know what I'm talking about at all. It sounds cool though, you know, right? And because it sounds cool and it sounds like, and I'm delivering it with authority, a lot of you will take my word for it. Do not take my word. Do what my father used to always tell me to do. Go to the source, which is why I'm going to scare you some more. We're gonna go to the source.
Uh-oh.
Yep, we gotta do that. And I'm about to bring out the boogie, the box of the boogeyman. All right, now y'all gonna be scared.
There you go.
It's terrible. Now, what I want you to do is just brace yourself, because you know what? Fear shall run amok all up in here. And I'm gonna tell you why fear shall run up amok all up in here, because we least expect it.
Bam!
It's gonna be a book. You're just gonna have to read.
A well-worn book, too.
A well-worn book. I have all kind of marks up in here. Because as you can see, I've been using the book to get to slapping people. Just slapping. Slapping them with the ignorance, you know, and hit them with the knowledge. The shots fired that comes from this book. Oh, yeah. Just feast your eyes on the reason for your fear. Oh, yeah. Now, let me go ahead and read from this book. Okay? Let's talk about, Dos Palmares. All right, what the heck is Dos Palmares? Like I just told you, all right? It is a famous quilombo. All right? For those of you trying to look it up, Dos, D-O-S, space, Palmares, P like Peter, A-L, M like Michael, A-R-E-S, Dos Palmares. This book right here is one of two parts, the Jogo de Angola from Luanda to Cyberspace, written by Gerard Taylor. It is the best research book, not written by TJ-Obi, all right, that is on the market, okay? And in some areas, it's even better than some of the areas of researchers of TJ. No disrespect, TJ, I'm just calling it how I read it, all right? So listen, what you want to hear is this. Several critical areas, all right? Dos Palmares, I'm reading here, refreshing my memory so I can make sure I quote properly. So you guys don't mess around and be like, he didn't say that, there was a comma right there, you know? Okay, now, Dos Palmares resisted invasion from three separate sources, two empires, the Portuguese Empire, the Dutch Empire, and the third source was the indigenous forces, meaning the Brasileiros who lived there, as well as from time to time, the raiders and bandits of various ethnic groups, including members of the native indigenous people there. All right, so there are times when everything was cool with, say the Tupi Guarana. Other times it's not so cool. You got a hot box about it. Okay, so the Quilombo resisted all of these forces, and also at various times had treaties with all of these forces. Why is this important that we're talking about? Because one of the important things that you need to know is, first, they were at war. I'm not even gonna read this part yet. I'm gonna save this for the bang a little bit later. You know, I just had to mark it up so I can come back to it and scare you some more. All right? The first is they were at war, which means the first thing that they were not doing was this right here. You know why? Because people at war, they've got guns. And you know what it looks like to them when you all doing exactly what your mighty cardio capoeira guy who tells you that he's teaching you the true art, okay? That or she's teaching you the true art, or they're teaching you the true art. You know, they're teaching you authentically, okay? What is the actual art itself? Yes. Oh my God, it's a clap. That's why it's the heater, but it's in Long Beach. You know that. All right.
Safety check.
Would you please? Thank you. There you go. All right. This is what it looks like. We're gonna go give you the hardcore Henry version. All right. So it's gonna be single person shooter. You're the shooter. I'm the shooter. All right.
Wow.
Here I am. All right. Oh wait a minute. You don't even know. Wait a minute. You know what? If I do this here, do this move right here real good. You don't even know about how sweet. Wait. Why? You can't be shooting me. Don't shoot me because no. You didn't win not one war doing that. You can't win. You see how shocked you are at this point in time? But now, let's see, you're gonna pull the gun up and do what I do. You're not gonna do this. Oh no, because when they start pulling the gun up, right? When they start pulling the gun up, you close on them. You close on them, you move the gun out the way. Now where does this come from, all right? This actually comes from a whole bunch of the other stuff they don't teach you. The fighting system is based upon several critical elements, including the lessons, number one, the lessons of the Orisha. There are 401 different Orisha. 401 different Orisha, at least. The number 401 has a mystical and spiritual significance, which is not gonna be got into in this video. But you need to know that, because that means that there are 401 different primary footwork methods. And the so-called Jenga is not the base of the art. And on top of that, that's not what it's called. I said this to you before. The collective name for the footwork movements, the level changing, you know, the postures, all this good stuff, the movements, the offensive and defensive combinations and transitions of this fighting system. There's several names. You know, but two of them are Yepa and Nsanga. Notice that don't sound like Jinga. You know why? Because there ain't no damn Jinga. That's why. The brothers and sisters of Africa, you know what they weren't speaking? Portuguese. So the moment you hear a Portuguese name for anything of the system, it is wrong, by definition. All right? Secondly, I keep saying this. There's a person. Jinga is a person. She is, as proven here, in this book here. You know what? That might scare you a little too much. But in this book right here, you will be able to see the history. I want you to go to the source of what I'm talking about so you can have the information that your messengers don't even have. They don't even know what I'm telling you right now. And the ones who do know, double shame on them because they're triple lying to you. All right? There's only about like four who know anyway. You know, right? Now, Jinga is the Ngolo of Ndongo. She is also the greatest warrior in the history of our art. I'm going to say it again. She is the greatest warrior in the history of our art. It ain't the person that you miscall Zumbi dos Palmares because his name ain't Zumbi. That's not a name. That is really, once again, I know I'm making you mad. You know, I can see you over here. He's growling, you know, stupid Coach Ross. He's always saying stuff, and you don't know what he's talking about. But wait. I have the concrete evidence of the collection of hundreds of years of history with hundreds of books in the bibliography, in the pages. Check it out. You got hundreds of these mugs, man. Hundreds of citations. Hundreds of notes, all this good stuff. Would your instructor don't know none of that, not one bit of it. He needs to buy this book too, or she needs, or they need to buy this book too. Your boy head coach Ross knows it and is bringing it to you. I want you to know. This is how you're able to separate the fact from the fiction. All right. Now, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna look it up in the book here, so you guys can so you can see exactly how to do this yourself.
While we're breaking, the book is available on Amazon, $16.99 all day.
Yes, sir. Well said. See, you see why I have my coach here? He helps me out. I do goofy stuff, and he makes sure that I don't look like an idiot. You know, right? You see, let me pull this out. I'm gonna pull out the index, and I'm gonna look into this index and pull up so-called Zumbi right here. I happen to have that information memorized as part. I'm pursuing my PhD in African studies and the human performance sciences. So I have this memorized, but what I want to do is I want to cite specifically from this particular source so that when you go check it out yourself, you'll be able to see, we will literally be on the same page, literally, all right? First off, read here, all right, there we go, yeah. First off, his name was not Zumbi. It's actually, read it right here, all right? Look it up. Look it up in the index and read right here, Zumbi. Read all of this stuff right here. This is what I'm citing from right here. This area right here. All these pages, 1921, 97, 105, 107, 113, 114, etc. All right? His name was not Zumbi. Zumbi came about the same way the so-called Capoeira came about. The same way the so-called Angola came about, and the same way that most of your information came about, the person who said they didn't know what the hell they was talking about, right, is a mispronunciation of Nganga Nzumba. Nganga Nzumba is a religious and warrior chief title that was famous among the Imbangala. Who are the Imbangala? The Imbangala are warriors from a specific area in Central Africa, Congo.
That sounds familiar.
That's where Kipura is from. These same Imbangala were rampaging warriors. They fight anybody. I don't care who you are. They fight each other. They fight your mama. Fight your grandmother. They would fight their grandmother and grandmother, but their mother and grandmother would kick their butt, so they didn't want to do that. You know, right? And they would fight the Portuguese. They would make alliances with the Portuguese. It don't matter. If it's a squad, they down with it. If it's a fight, they like that. Okay? Well, these same King Bangala thought it was a great idea to ease on up the road, you know, to the kingdom of Ndongo, which was part of the kingdom of Congo. What? Oh, yeah. See, if you would go to my blog, which I keep telling you to do, if you go to Capoeira That Works, all right, on Blogger, that's attackjimcapoeira.blogspot.com, which is in the link to this video right here, you would have picked this information up, which is why I keep telling you to do these things, and which is why I don't keep repeating myself over and over and over again, because I already told you where to go. You know, if I answer all the questions I get, the repetitions of this, I'd be saying the same thing literally 30,000 times a year. My tongue would just slap me. That's what happened, all right? Okay, so what happened here, okay, go to my blog, sign up, read it. I know, scary, the whole idea of reading. Boo! I know, I'm sorry about that. I'll wait for you to get back up off the couch. All right, get back up, you ready? All right. Like I was saying to you, the Mangala decided they ease on up the road to the kingdom of Ndongo, all right? Which is part of the king, of the empire of Congo. Yes, the kingdom of Ndongo is so-called at the same place that the Portuguese miscalled Angola. They are part of the kingdom of Congo. So is the kingdom of Soyo, so is the kingdom of Benguela. There are multiple areas that are all part of the kingdom of Congo. Like California is part of the United States. Oh yeah, let that marinate. That's a major part of the puzzle. Why there is a Kipura in Angola, in Ndongo, Mitch called Angola. Angola got that name because the Portuguese heard the term Ngolo, and the Ngolo is the name for the office of their constitutional leader. It's like saying president, all right? So the Portuguese ease on up the road, all right, right up on the brothers and sisters, and was like, take me to your leader. And they was like, hell no, nah, the Ngolo don't want to talk to you. And they were like, Ngolo? Ngolo's not what it is. The Portuguese was like, Angola? They were like, no, the Ngolo don't want to talk to Angola. The Ngolo does not want to talk to Angola. Boy, bye. That's what the Mbundu did. And then Mbundu went back to the money, and he was like, he can't even say Mbundu. That's what it was like, all right? The Portuguese, in the meantime, went back to Portugal. They were like, King Gaffle everybody for no reason whatsoever, especially the niggers. We went to a place called Angola. And the people there, the Angolans, were very rich in the yellow metal of gold. We've got to get that. That's how it started. They came on back, okay? They came on back. And that's how the Portuguese started referring to the kingdom of Ndongo as Angola. That's also how, same process, the great majority of names, cultural practices, fighting systems, spiritual systems, all of that was also screwed by the same reason, by the same people for the same reason, all right? Kipura became Capoeira, as proven by here. And wait a minute, I know you're, wait. And then another one, boom! Just fear in your brains, because there's another book. You're gonna have to read not one, but two books. I know, it's terrible, all right? As proven multiple times by experts who have been practicing this art longer than you, and who have done the requisite extensive research, scientific research, which you must do in order to actually acquire an operational understanding of the art. You cannot avoid the scientific research and have any form of operational understanding of the art, because you will be denuded of the history. You won't know what it is you're supposed to achieve. You don't know how these things happen. You can't build a tomorrow if you don't even understand that today is today. That's the problem. That's what cardio capoeira has. Cardio capoeira is an exercise regime which has its roots in the tourist department of Salvador. We'll get there later. All right? And as a result, its whole purpose is not to teach you self-defense. But the practitioners and the teachers co-opt the history of the warriors. Us, my family, and people like us, which ain't you. All right? All of you with the cardio capoeira, that's not you. But the great thing you've done is that you've come to my video so that you can actually begin to learn so that it could be you. Okay?
Welcome.
There you go. There you go. So what the Imbangala did, taking it back to them, they mobbed up the kingdom of Ndongo, all right? And they ran across the Ngolo, who at that time was a sister named Jinga, G-I-N-G-A. All right? There's all kind of giant lies about this sister. They said that she was defeated by the Portuguese. She was not defeated by the Portuguese. She walked upon the Portuguese. And she lived for 85 years. 85 years. And this is, we're talking about the late 1500s here. She lived longer than a lot of you will right now. All right? And she did this under conditions of war. She rose to prominence at around the age of 16. She led her armies from the front for 20 years. 20 years. She beat the Dutch so bad that they joined her. They're like, no, Negress, don't. Wait, hold it. You know, I got tired of you kicking me right here. Let me go ahead and help you kick them over there. Just kick them. Don't kick me. You know, right? So they helped her. They didn't want to. She made them. She said, either you help me fight them, or else I'm going to eradicate all of you. Now, they didn't want to do that because that would then send Portugal directly to war with Holland. So they'd have to go through all kinds of twists and turns and all kinds of gyrations to avoid war. They have to look at war on multiple fronts. War of acquisition, of conquest, trying to create colonies, and also fighting off assaults from their homeland by European powers, all right? So they didn't want that. The Portuguese, lucky for them, were also similarly extended. So while they each growled at each other and made these aggressive sounds, and you know, in the back door, the diplomats were hammering out, you know, agreements, and they agreed not to go to war, at least not the homelands, but on the seas and the colonies, different thing. They were constantly clashing there. So Jinga, knowing this, oh yeah, she knew this. How did she know this? Well, I'll tell you what, BAM! If you read that book, all right, you would discover that Jinga was such a genius that she learned all of their languages. All of them. She could speak Dutch, she could speak Portuguese, and she could speak the strata of Dutch and Portuguese. So she could speak to the soldier, and she could speak to the king. These are different forms of Portuguese. Think of it like this. Those of you who are English speakers, think of it like this. Think of England. Think of England. Think of the England that they speak in, the type of English they speak in, the Brecons. All hood. Just all hood. And then think of the way bankers speak. They're all stuffy and proper. And then think about the people who have, like, titles. You know, sir this, lady that. You know, they're all with the pinky in the air, and the monocles and spectacles and the bowler hats and everything. In the what ho and everything, you know? That's a joke. I know that I'm not disrespecting anybody's ethnicity or your upper. That was funny. Quit hating. Anyway, so Queen Ngolo Jinga knew how to speak this very strata, but they did not know how to speak her language. They assumed that she was ignorant purely because she was both black and a woman. Black from Africa, she was the queen of Ndongo, and she was a woman, she was a she. So they were like, oh no, please, they just, you know, no, we're gonna go ahead and get it. And that was their last thoughts. She offed all of them. She beat them so thoroughly that they refused to even aggress upon her kingdom for the next nearly 200 years.